السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. This is Dr. Majdi Muhammad Bet Ali Suleiman, the moderator for this webinar. Before proceeding, I would like to emphasize the following. This webinar is recorded and it is live in YouTube. Link is available in the chat box. The webinar program link is available as well in the chat box. Attendees, kindly write your full name in profile. A very good morning to Dr. Ali Saud Al-Mughiri, all dignitaries, our resource persons for today's event, special guests and participants. Thank you all for joining us here today. In line with Oman Vision 2040, we, the UTAS-Nizwa, is honored to host a series of research webinars that mold and sharpen young, talented minds. The engineering department of UTAS-Nizwa, since its beginning, has shown enormous growth in all fronts with diploma, advanced diploma, and Bachelor of Technology courses in engineering. The department is adequately staffed with around 104 staff comprising nationals and expats from various continents and with 1,632 students. The department trains young minds under computer engineering, electrical engineering, electronics and communication, mechanical engineering and oil and gas engineering, which suits them for the job market. The college strives towards Oman Vision 2040 by installing research potentials, imparting new technologies and embedding qualitative attributes to its students and society as well. The theme for today's webinar is challenges and scopes and for the fourth industrial revolution, covering the areas of artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, drone technologies, and robotics. As we are aware, the world is moving so quickly that every minute of every day, this is all being driven at an ever-increasing pace by digital technologies that is transforming the way we live and work. And it is time that every industry and business recognizes the radical shift happening before them. We believe this research webinar series will bring insight to all participants. Thank you once again. Now, I take the opportunity to welcome our respected Dr. Ali Saud Al-Mughiri, Assistant Director General for Technological Education UTAS, to inaugurate the event by inaugural and welcome address. Welcome, Dr. Ali, the stage is yours.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you, Dr. Magdi. Thank you, Dr. Ahmed, the College Dean. Good morning, everyone. It is my pleasure to welcome all the participants today for the second day events of the research webinar series conducted by University of Technology and Applied Science Nizwa. For the speakers, I would like to say a great thanks for the coming here to share your knowledge and experience. And we are really proud to see that this series of webinar are coming along with the developing the new programs for this university. Therefore, your knowledge and experience will be one of the input, and I'm sure will help us during the review, the review of the curriculum, and also I'm really sure that will add value to the outcomes of the programs. As all we know and aware that it is very important to align our programs to the market needs in terms of skills, scientific innovations, analysis, and critical thinking. So I believe that this research webinar will have an innovative insight to all stakeholders in UTAS. In addition to that, it is required from us to achieve the KPIs of QS and Vision 2040. And it is clearly stated on Vision 2040 educational priorities, the universities in Oman should be within top 300 university according to the QS ranking by the first period 2030. So for that reason, these webinars will strengthen the partnership between the academy and industry. Also, I think it is good to know the coming period will be more focused in developing the university academic program. So I really hope to see all of you again there during the conducting workshop with all stakeholders in order to make sure the graduate from the university have skill, our graduate from this university as skills align with the economic needs. So finally, I would like to say to thanks also Dr. Ahmed Shahri, College Dean, and his team for the great effort to come up with this well-organized events, inshallah. And Dr. Ahmed, I'm really excited to hear or to see the remarkable points from this event, inshallah. So now let's start this event. Let's start learning from you. Let's know about addressing the local needs through the unmanned vehicle systems. And let's learn more about IoT. Let's learn more about the integration fourth IR technology to the smart educations. Thank you all. And I wish the success of this event. Wish you all the best, inshallah.
Thank you, Dr. Ali, for your warm and pleasant inaugural address. As many knows, famous people have said, knowledge is the greatest resource which can change the people and the world. Now it is time to equip ourselves with the latest trends and technologies for the eminent keynote speakers. Participants are requested to post their questions in the chat box or can raise their hands and unmute at the end of each presentation. Our first keynote speaker for today's events is Dr. Ahmed Al-Mashari, Associate Professor at Sultan Qaboos University. Dr. Al-Mashari holds a PhD in Computer Science and Engineering. He is currently an Associate Professor at Sultan Qaboos University. He has published journals and conference papers in areas of computer architecture, reconfiguring computing, embedded system, digital logic, and wireless networks. Dr. Al-Mashari's recent focus is on artificial intelligence, embedded vision systems, and designing hardware accelerators to speed up the performance of such systems. He has co-founded the Embedded and Interconnected Vision Systems Laboratory. He is a recipient of the National Research Award in the ICT sector. Dr. Al-Mashari is a senior IEEE member, and he is the founder of IEEE Oman chapter. The past chair of the IEEE Oman section. So Dr. Al-Mashari will present the webinar on exploiting IR4 in Oman, addressing the local needs through UVS and AI. Dr. Ahmed Al-Mashari, we are welcome you for this webinar, and the mic is yours.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Majdi, for the introduction and to your team. Special thanks, Dr. Ahmed Al-Shahri, Dr. Wissam, for inviting me here today to present this. I hope you can see me, hear me, and see the slides. If somebody can confirm, I would really appreciate it.
Yes, it is visible. Please go ahead, please.
Okay. Right. So what I want to talk about today, it's exploiting IR4 in Oman. And in particular, I want to talk about how you can address the local needs through the use of two prominent technologies of IR4, specifically unmanned vehicle systems and artificial intelligence. Now, before I begin, I have to give some acknowledgement. So some of the slides that you will see, especially in the first part, it was a collective effort between myself and my colleagues, Dr. Rashid Hajri, Dr. Amir Yahmadi, Dr. Nasr al-Maskariya, Dr. Shaham Alloush, and Dr. Mohammed Biswilem. Also, towards the end of the presentation, I'll talk about several research projects that we are actively working on. And these were funded by His Majesty Trust Fund, Sultan Qaboos University, Ministry of Higher Education, Research, Innovation, BP Oman, and the Office for the Conservation of the Environment, Diwan of Royal Court. So this is what I want to talk about today. I think it's only appropriate that we refresh what we know about IR4, a bit of history, some technologies, and certain challenges. And after that, I'll talk about the research projects that we are actively working on right now. Then I'll briefly highlight the role of academia when it comes to IR4 development advancement. And then I'll conclude with, talking a bit about the Embedded and Interconnected Vision Systems Laboratory, which is one of the facilities that are provided for students and faculty to advance and develop some of the technologies of IR4. So, first part, history, technologies, and challenges. You probably have seen this, this chronology in some format or another. So it started with the steam engines, which give rise to factories, and that basically was the landmark for the first industrial revolution. Then with the fossil fuels, electricity, now we delve into the second industrial revolution. In the third industrial revolution, we have ushered robotics, which led to automation, and that also brought us to a whole host of problems, which I'll talk about later on. And then comes the fourth industrial revolution. Now, when people talk about fourth industrial revolution, some may have the misconception that fourth industrial revolution basically refers to automation. It's not. The automation was the landmark of third. The fourth industrial revolution is more into data. Okay. Now, when you have steam engines and you have factories and trains, that really did change the demography of cities and urban areas, because what happened is that people from rural and remote areas moved into the cities looking for job opportunities. That did change the demography. But at the same time, it gave rise to current superpowers such as the USA. So it has, you know, advantages, disadvantages. We see the same thing with the second industrial revolution. You have pollution in one hand, but the other hand, you have economies which are based and built on fossil fuels, such as the economy of the GCC countries. In the third industrial revolution, we start to see loss of jobs, basically job destruction, because automation allows factories to do repetitive work without the need for human resources. Which means that the reason I'm showing you this slide, we do expect that we will see pros and cons when it comes to the fourth industrial revolution, which will be detailed in the following slide. So where this IR4 comes from, it actually was coined by Klaus Schwab. He is, if you are familiar with the World Economic Forum, he is the founder of that. And he actually wrote a book on IR4, which I really recommend that you read it. It's, you can download for free, you can listen to it on YouTube. He really highlights what to expect in the following years and the technologies that we need to anticipate when it comes to IR4. And when you say IR4, it's not really one thing. It's actually a blend of different technologies. It includes artificial intelligence, and under artificial intelligence comes all other things like machine learning, machine vision, computer vision, all these different terms that you hear. It's actually part of this AI, artificial intelligence. And then you have IoT, the Internet of Things, which is basically billions and billions of devices are expected to connect to one another, which means that you have parameters in the environment being measured constantly, sent out to the cloud for processing, where you can extract some trends, extract some knowledge, and then use that knowledge to make some decisions. And whenever you say IoT, immediately comes after that big data analytics, of course. Then we have robotics and unmanned vehicle systems, and then we have 3D printing, augmented reality, virtual reality, and so on and so forth. So the point I'm trying to stress here, IR4 is not one thing, it's actually multiple technologies. When you blend them together, you get IR4. Now, I'm sure that some of you might be a bit uncomfortable because maybe I dropped a technology here or there, such as smart materials, innovative materials. The reason I'm showing you these specific technologies is because it will pave the way later on when I talk about the research projects that we worked on. It doesn't mean that the other technologies are less important. Now, what people expect is that we will start to lose jobs. Anything that's being repetitive, it can be automated. Anything that requires, you know, an army of people going through data, trying to analyze it, extract some knowledge, it can be done now automatically. So we do expect to see some job destruction. And I know this is a very sensitive topic, especially for Oman in this period. But the bright side is, it is expected also that we will see some job creation. You probably have read all these reports that talk about future jobs, drone pilot, big data programmer, robot programmer, and so on and so forth. So on one hand, we see job destruction. On the other hand, we see job creation. So what are the advantages of IR4? First of all, now we have much better access to information and knowledge. It's much easier now, okay? If you compare it to 15, 20 years ago when we were students back then, accessing information was very, very difficult. You have to go to the library. Now, you know, the term is just go and Google it, right? The other thing is that once you have automation and proper use of data, I can improve the quality of products at cheaper cost, because now I have less human resources needed for the product, and that product is being perfected because I can constantly log all the data. I can use algorithms to figure out what was wrong with the product from last month, improving that. Now the next month product would be much better. Also, it's expected that we will see an increased average life expectancy because of the breakthroughs in the medical sector. We have seen some reports that indicate that the average of life expectancy will rise. Of course, it will differ from one nation to another, but overall, we will see that average going up. Also, because of the introduction of self-driving cars, it's expected that the fatalities and injuries in the roads will be much less. Okay. Whenever you replace a crazy person with a machine, you would expect to see, you know, better behavior in roads. Now, on the other hand, because we want to keep this balanced, there are certain disadvantages. First of all, there are concerns of increased unemployability. Anything, and I mentioned this several times, anything that's repetitive, anything that's routine, it can be easily replaced by a machine or a computer. So that would be the biggest challenge and the biggest concern of IR4. On the other hand, there are concerns about the privacy and security, because slowly computers will become ubiquitous. They're everywhere. They listen to what we say, they record everything that we do, and then if they get hacked, then your privacy will be endangered. And that is one also of the concerns. A lot of people are worried about the use of drones, robots in wars. So you have weaponized robots, and I'm sure that most of the audience have watched the Terminator series. So would that be something that is conceivable, let's say in 20 years of now, 30 years of now? And also there is a concern about the rise of hate speech, especially in the social media. Given that everyone now have access, content is available everywhere, everyone can give opinion, and that sometimes causes some clashes between people, and there are concerns about that as well. Now, when it comes to the challenges, IR4 is based on informatics, on data, as I mentioned before, which means now you have to instill certain skills in the next generation. You need people who know how to handle machines, how to program robots, how to debug and troubleshoot a robot. Those are the skills that are required in the near future. Additionally, if you want to have an IoT deployment in a city for the purpose of having a smart city, then there is a need to have some adequate communication infrastructure, in particular wireless, because IoT was conceived as being wireless sensor networks. If you remember, that was the older generation. We had machine to machine, M2M, then we have WSN, wireless sensor networks, and now we have IoT. So it's conceived as being a wireless network. Unless you have that, you know, adequate communication infrastructure, IoT cannot be reliable. The thing is that once you have these billions and billions of devices scattered around, each device is sending some information. Collectively, you have huge amount of data that's being sent up to the cloud. So you need storage and you need some processing capability. And that's another challenge. You have to have some cloud and edge computing facilities that are available there so that you can make use of that data, because unless you analyze data, extract knowledge, and extract trends, there is no point of having that data. It's just too huge to analyze by humans. Finally, you have to have some kind of regulations to deal with the robots and how to use robots complemented with AI. And we actually have now, you know, what's known as roboethics. And I always like to give this example. It's expected that in the near future, you will have a robot servant at home. Now, that robot servant, it can, you know, help at home, but at the same time, it hears everything, it records everything. So would you be comfortable having a robot servant at home, which can leak all, you know, everything that happens at home, you know, somewhere else? And would you be sleeping tightly, you know, at night, knowing that there is a machine that can walk and talk and is able, it's somewhere in your home? Would you be, would you feel comfortable sleeping at night knowing that? So that's why, you know, advancing robots and AI is important, but equally, what's equally important is to work on the ethics, to work on the regulations, just to make sure that these robots, they maintain and preserve the human life, and they maintain and preserve the privacy of humans. Okay, now the second part of this is to talk about some of the research projects that have been done or we're actively working on currently that uses multiple of these technologies that I spoke about before. What I did is that I thought maybe I should split this into domains, and for each domain, I'll give one or two examples. So when you talk about wildlife and environment, you probably have heard and, you know, read these news, disturbing news about poachers, you know, illegal hunters who would, you know, break into a wild reserve in an Oman, and then they would basically kill some of these animals. And these animals are very endangered. So probably the audience are familiar with oryx, almaha, but that's not the only endangered animals. We have gazelles, we have leopards. So there are a bunch of animals which are endangered, and they're actually threatened by poachers. And we keep hearing these news about breaking into a reserve. Sometimes they get caught, sometimes they don't, but these are disturbing news. Now, what we thought we can do, and that was basically done in collaboration with the Office of Conservation for Environment under DIWAN, we thought that we can invest in two particular technologies to see if we can help the inspectors and the rangers in their job to prevent this, these poaching activities. And those two particular technologies were basically drones, which is basically an instance of unmanned vehicle systems, as well as machine vision, which is, you know, a subdomain under artificial intelligence. So we have actually two different projects. I show you only one project. The other one, I cannot show it at the point at this point because still not really published. And we're actually working on the third, third phase of this project. So I'll just talk about the first phase, which basically using drones and machine vision to be able to detect the whereabouts of the animals, and we can even give a count of that. So what you could see here on the picture on the left, this was in Ras al-Shajar Reserve in Qriyat. We had the drone flying, covered different terrains, and then we took all these images, hundreds of them, and then we fed them to a deep neural network, which is basically known now as deep learning. So we fed it to the machine, and then we were able to extract the trends, and then we can do semi-real-time recognition of animals, and we can give a count. This is important for the inspectors because they sometimes they need to know where these animals are, what are the numbers, so that it would be easier for them to dispatch, you know, those inspectors to the right location. And when we were there as well, that wasn't really in the plan, but while discussing with one of the inspectors, he mentioned that donkeys are an issue because donkeys, they come into the wild reserve and they start to compete with the gazelles with their food. So there's a competition. And we thought, okay, since we are doing one species, why don't we just go to do the other species? So using the same data set, we trained in using that deep neural network, and we were able also to recognize the other species and give a count. Now, the other project, and this is a major project that we're working on. It's really complex, which has multiple components. Due to the time constraint, I will not be able to talk about it in details, but I can just talk about, a few aspects of it. Now, this part of Oman's shore, the Strait of Hormuz, so this is Musandam, Ras Musandam, this part here, this narrow passage, it's a pass for about 35% of world's oil, okay? So 35% passes from this passage, and you have thousands and thousands of cargo ships which go through this narrow passage. So it is expected that from time to time, there might be some contaminations, either oil tankers leaking some oil or cargo ships leaking diesel from their engines. And unless it's being detected early and being contained and cleaned, what happens a few days later, you will see these incidents. This is basically on Musandam. So you'll see, oil, washing off the beach. And now it becomes, painful process to go and try to clean this up. So currently, the way this works is that somebody would report that there is contamination, either through satellite images, or maybe there's a fishing boat, they will notice that there seems to be some discoloring, it might be a contamination, they would just report it to the Environment Authority. The Environment Authority, they have to contact the Maritime Security Center. Sometimes they would need to contact Air Force to dispatch a CASA aircraft, very sophisticated aircraft, which is equipped with multiple cameras, and they go visit the location, take pictures, and then they send that back to the Environment Authority. After analysis, they would come to the conclusion that there is actually some kind of leak, and they would coordinate with the Navy. They would dispatch a team, a capable team, and they would go and take samples, do some cleanup. They analyze the sample. Sometimes from the sample, they would be able to trace who was the, which ship was the cause of the leak. And if they figure that out, then they can take some legal action, and this repeats. Now, this part over here, reporting and coordinating and dispatching, it takes sometimes days. It's very, very time consuming, and it's very costly, okay? Especially when you dispatch a CASA. So we talked to Environment Authority. We had several meetings. We have actually one member on board with our project. And we thought that we can use UVS and machine vision to try to reduce that time it takes to detect that there is a contamination or not. So what we do is that whenever there is a report of some contamination, or occasionally if you can dispatch a patrol, you can have you have a swarm of drones complemented with a USV, an unmanned surface vehicle, and they work together to visit the location autonomously, figure out if there is contamination or no contamination, again, autonomously, and then report that to the mainland. That would save a lot of money, it will save time, and it will make it much more flexible to dispatch this. And actually, this is a very complex project, because think about it, you have USVs, you have autonomous procedures, you have communication and coordination between the drones and the boats, all of them are autonomous, you have some remote sensing, because we do remotes, we do thermal imaging, we do visual, and we do multispectral. And then all that information has to be analyzed, sent to the mainland for taking action, okay? But if you ask me, would this be possible 10 years ago, I would say definitely not. Today, with the availability of resources and equipment, it is possible. So the first step in this complex system is to do some simulation. I'm showing you one of the simulations here. We use a robot operating system to model the drone that we have, and then we make the drone hover over an area which appears to be, you know, seawater with some contamination. And I apologize for the low resolution. And what you see here is what the drone sees. Now, given this technology being available to us, we can do these analysis in lab before we go to the field. This wasn't really possible 10 years ago. Now, once you are done with the simulation, we do emulation. And in the lab, the EIVS lab, which I will talk about at the end of the presentation or towards the end of the presentation, we have actually an arena with multiple drones and some ground vehicles, and we can do a bunch of fun stuff with these drones. So I'll play the video now. This drone now is hovering over this map, which basically, again, mimics seawater with some contamination. It's a black and white because in the early stage, we just use grayscale analysis. We don't really need colors. Color would come at a later stage. But what you can see here now, we can see what the drone is seeing in real time, and we can get all the vitals from the drone. Okay, and all of this will help us to develop our controllers, which will then be embedded in outdoor drones systems, and then we can do some field tests. Again, this wasn't available 10 years ago. Now it's available. Now we can do a lot of things, which wasn't possible in the past. Okay. Now, the next stage we were supposed to do some field tests in Missendon. With this pandemic, it has been delayed from month to another, and now over a year has passed, and we are unable to do these field tests because of the restrictions. So what we thought that we can do until the restrictions are being alleviated, we can do these experiments, in a field test, in an outdoor setting, but it would be within Sultan Qaboos University. So we've gone to one of these pools, we have renovated, it's filled out with seawater, we have some contamination. The picture that you see in front of you, we use this picture for propaganda. We put it in our Twitter account just to get attention to the stuff that we do. So basically what we do with this drone is that we take many pictures with different cameras, visual, thermal, and multispectral, and then we go to the lab, we start to analyze. So at this stage, we're in the analysis stage. We're trying to, see what are the special trends of a contamination surrounded by seawater. We are hoping that by next year, we'll do field test in Missendon. And once we do that, we will, publish some of the results that we have, in the traditional outlets, such as papers and so on. But also we will put it in our Twitter account. If you're interested, you can just follow us and see what's going on. Okay. Now, another sector is the medical applications. This work was developed with students as part of one of the courses, and I worked with them to see how we can use machine vision in order to maintain some kind of social distancing. And what you see here in front of you, the students took this feed where a camera is mounted on top, and then what they do machine vision to detect persons, and then they would measure the distance between two people. You can do this now using a geometric calibration. So you can turn pixels into centimeters and meters, and then you can measure the distance between people. And whenever that distance goes below a certain threshold, you can sound an alarm. Okay, there's a group of people who are huddling around. They're not really paying any respect to social distancing. Okay, again, it took the students about 2 months to develop it. I'm pretty sure other students, in UTAS or somewhere else, they can do something very similar. The tools are available. It just requires students to be encouraged. They have to learn new things, and then they can do amazing stuff. Another sector is the tourism and heritage preservation. In Oman, we have many landmarks, forts, fortresses, old buildings, mosques, and so on and so forth. Unfortunately, we don't have detailed 3D models of these landmarks. And these are nowadays very, very important, because if you want to promote tourism, you need these 3D models. Now, 3D models basically means you send people to take measurements and take pictures, and they try to, you know, turn the landmark into a software 3D model that can be used for multiple purposes. But that's very expensive and very time costly. It takes sometimes from days to weeks. We thought we want to use, you know, unmanned vehicle systems, specifically drones, complemented with computer vision and embedded systems in order to turn this into a job that can be done in half a day. So I'll just show you one sample. Here we fly the drone, and it will basically circulate the SQ tower. It's close to the cultural center, if you are familiar with the whereabouts of SKU. And then we turn this into this model. Okay, so this can be done in few hours. So rather than spending days and weeks trying to come up with the model, it can be done in few hours. And now you have the model which can be used in multiple purposes, for restoration, for, you know, promoting the site, for any purpose, you have it and you can use it. Another project, which is basically into the tourism sector, we worked with students trying to develop a robot that can be used in museums. And this is not really a new idea. This tour guide robot has been there for years and years. But for the students, it was a challenge because they have to learn a new environment, which is robot operating system, and they have to model the whole museum setting in software. So what you could see here is the robot moving around. It tried to avoid different places and pillars within the museum. And this robot, it can listen to questions coming from the visitors of the museum. It can respond to questions either textually or it can use speech. And the students basically blended multiple technologies. They have used, of course, robotics, some machine vision. They have done natural language processing, NLP, text-to-speech, speech-to-text. So it was really a comprehensive project. And the students were awarded the best prize for the best ICT project for FURA about 2 years ago. So it's something fun that we work with the students. And I show these slides because I want to encourage students that you can do it as well. The tools are there. Just learn, innovate, and your work will be recognized. Okay. Currently, we're working with another group of students to do some crop monitoring using drones. The idea is simple. You want to send a drone. The drone will scan a farm, survey a farm, and then it will generate a report that the farmer can use to know whether, you know, certain parts of the farm is under stress, it needs more attention, some water, whatever it is. So again, we dispatch the drone. We have here an agriculture research center, research station story in SKU, and we have deployed the drone there to survey different locations. And what we did is that we offload the images that were taken using the multispectral camera, and we do live processing. It takes about 5 seconds to generate the report. Okay. Of course, it took some time to do some tweaking, but eventually we managed to hit that 5 second processing time. And eventually what the farmer will get, this is the picture, the original picture. Now you get a picture with which is annotated with color code. Okay, so whenever you have a green area, this means that you have crops which is not really under stress. But whenever you have yellow or red, it means this area is under stress or it's not really cropped yet. And the nice thing about this, the students developed an algorithm that can even detect that there is this part which is not really part of the farm. It's just a road. So it wouldn't really process it. It wouldn't really show you these false positive that this area is under stress just because it's a gravel road. Instead, it will segment the area knowing that this is part of the farm, this is not part of the farm, and then it will give you the report. Okay, I'm coming towards the end. I hope I'm not taking too much time. So I have two things that I want to talk about: the role of the academia in adopting and advancing IR4, and then I'll talk about the lab. So the way I see this is that academicians, they are responsible for instilling knowledge, skills, and experience of IR4 into the students. Okay. The project that you have seen before, some of them were done by students. Students have to learn new things, so that's knowledge. Students have to learn some languages or some tools, so that's the skill. And students have learned how to, you know, debug, troubleshoot. They have basically had this experience of IR4, which is very, very important for the students. On the other hand, knowledge, skills, and experience is one thing, but the way of thinking is something else that you have to instill in the students. Number one, creativity and innovation. Give them a problem, a challenging problem, and see how they think. Students are really good when it comes to thinking out of the box, because they don't, you know, academicians, they have years of experience, but after some time, you might end up having what's known as groupthink. Students don't have that, so they have the ability to be creative and innovative, and they can think out of the box. So you want to take advantage of that. The other thing is that you want to keep throwing problems to students and see how they think, because you want to encourage them to do some critical thinking. And what's important, which is really difficult with students, is to push them to keep learning. Students sometimes don't like to read, and that's global. It's not, you know, specific or, you know, to a particular region. Students don't like to read. So you have to encourage them to read new stuff. And that really pays off, because at one point you will notice that students know about a particular topic more than you do. Okay. And that happened to me in quite often. So it's really interesting when you see the student telling you about things that you haven't learned from, and then now you'll learn from the students. The last thing that's basically one of the responsibilities of academia, you have to strengthen the collaboration with the industry in IR4. We do have some projects from industry. I couldn't really disclose them in today's topic because either they are unpublished, or we have a term in the contract with the industry that we cannot talk about the project. But there are many problems that the industry have. You need to approach them, speak in their language, in the industry language, not in the academia language, and you will be amazed of the problems that are available there that need some solutions. And you can tackle them with some of the technology that we spoke about in the previous slides. Last part, I want to talk about the EIVS lab. So the EIVS lab, which stands for Embedded and Interconnected Vision Systems Lab, it was inaugurated March 2020, just 1 week before the lockdown. Still, even though there was a lockdown, we tried our best to keep it active and have the activities going on. The lab was sponsored by BP Oman. We thank them for that. And the mission of the lab, we want to turn it into a platform for students, researchers, and entrepreneurs so they can sit together, talk, discuss, think of problems, and find solutions to. And the areas that we cover currently, embedded vision systems, AI, especially in UVS and robotics, augmented reality, and hardware acceleration for UVS using FPGAs. And the services that we provide, we teach courses in this lab, we conduct experiments in this lab, we do some R&D, research and development. We had a plan to offer a number of workshops and training sessions for the whole community, not only for SKU. Unfortunately, as I said, once we had the lockdown, we cannot really have, you know, visitors into the lab in large numbers. So this has to be postponed till 2022, hopefully if things get better. But once that happens, we will start to release several training sessions and workshops. We have already identified three of them, and we will have them out there. And we want students, scholars to come to the lab and learn new things, because we believe that once you have knowledge everywhere, that will help everyone. Because, you know, in the future, if I want to collaborate with somebody else, maybe somebody in Sahar or Nizwa, it will be easier for me to find people to collaborate with, because the knowledge is out there. So this 3D model of the lab, I'll show you towards the end a video that basically shows you what's happening inside. But what we have here this part of the lab where we do teaching and we conduct the experiments with the students. This part is where we do the experiments. That drone platform that I discussed before, that's where we have it here. We have a couple of research assistants and a postdoc that's working on several projects. We have in the lab several drones. Currently, we have, I think, 5 drones that we have different kinds. We have 3 UGVs. We have 2 unmanned service vehicles, and we have 1 autonomous, I shouldn't say autonomous. It's a remote ROV. So basically, it's a submarine that you could send, below surface. You can take imagery, and it's tethered to the surface, so you can basically send all these images in real time and do some processing, okay? We have also a quality inspection system, which you will see in the video, so I'll leave it till then. And we have different kind of platforms which students can use to do development. So we do have a couple of Raspberry Pis for students to do some embedded system development, so they do computer vision, machine vision on Raspberry Pi. So that the challenge would be, how would you fit a complex problem in a very small board? And the reason we do this is because we want students to think of ways how you can optimize a system which runs fine on a server, but it will not be running smoothly on an embedded system because of the limited resources. So we wanted students to come up with ways of how to try to optimize the system so it would fit on a small platform. We also do have FPGAs for hardware acceleration, for those of you who are familiar with FPGAs. We have different kinds of cameras. Some of them are tethered to the drones. Some of them are, the normal ones that you would use for photography. And we actually have developed a course we call the Embedded Vision System course, specifically to be taught in this lab. And in this course, it might appear that it's a computer vision course, but it's not. It's actually a blend of different topics. So we tell students about the pipeline of a machine vision system, and we try to map it to the human vision system. And then we tell them about some of the basics of computer vision, but not only that. We tell them about the things that they need to make sure that the vision system that you have, it's actually reliable and it can be deployed, in industry or out in an outdoor setting. So we tell them about different kind of lightings, different kind of optics, lenses and sensors, and even image sensors. And we have also a session where we discuss, different kind of embedded vision systems. What are the pros and cons of each one, which one you use for a certain application, which ones you wouldn't. And this would be the last slide. I was rushing a bit because I was worried about the time I have. This is a clip. It's only 1 minute. It shows you the lab that we have and some of the things that we do. Assuming that I know how to start it. Okay, thank you everyone. Again, I appreciate the opportunity that you've given me to talk about some of the stuff that we do with IR4. This is our Twitter account. If you would like to follow, there are already a couple of videos, some of the stuff that we have done in the past. If you follow it from time to time, we release some of the stuff that we do if you are interested. Jazakumullah khair, and if you have any questions, I'm ready for it.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ahmed Al-Mashari, for taking time from your busy schedule to be the guest speaker for today's webinar. Your presentation was a remarkable one, and the way that you stressed about the needs for the IR pros and cons, and its challenges. It was very useful and intriguing for the participants. I believe it was mind-blowing to hear about your real-time research experience using drones and AI techniques. Now we will go for the QA session, and we have a number of questions. We will start off with the chat box.
Dr. Majdi, should I read the question, because I'm having hard time to see any questions. Maybe if you can...
Doctor, if you can stop sharing the PowerPoint, please.
Sure.
Excellent.
If I may, Dr. Majdi, salam alaikum.
Yes, please.
I've been raising my hand. Maybe you didn't look at the hands. Anyways, thank you, Dr. Ahmed. This is the Dr. Ahmed Shahri, the college dean. I just want to welcome you once again. You are a great partner to UTAS-Nizwa, actually. You always, you know, we have always had this positive response from you all the time. You are very, very supportive of our, you know, events, of our, you know, workshops. And I just want to thank you for that always. I have one question, Dr. Ahmed, if I may. It's about in the framework of IR4. If you look at, you know, the jump market in Oman, what is the potential, I mean, for, you know, in the future for Oman in terms of, you know, IR4 and in terms of, you know, job market and in the IR4 field in general. Can, if you could elaborate on that, please. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ahmed. And in turn, I also thank you for inviting me again. And it's always a pleasure to see you. I still remember the last visit that I had to the college back when there was no pandemic and life was much easier to, you know, to go about. So I'm happy to see you here again. With regard to the potentials, I can easily identify three different technologies which can be easily used, and it can be, you know, take advantage of here in Oman. Number one, big data analytics. There are several companies who would have huge amount of logs, okay? And these companies, they want someone to help them with big data analytics, and that's something that the market can make use of, because it's not really that difficult. It's few concepts that you have to be aware of. You have to have some kind of infrastructure be set in place, and then you can start to be productive in this area. I already know that there are certain companies, some telecommunication company, they have already gone into big data analytics. So that market is expanding, and there is really a potential for, you know, younger generation to invest. The second technology, drones. From time to time, you hear people talking about drones. Mostly, it's being used currently for photography purposes and cinematography, but there have been several attempts to use drones for other purposes. You probably have heard a company called Wakan. They use drones in collaboration with Ministry of Agriculture for the 1 million palm tree project. The project that we have done, these projects can be turned into companies. You know, for example, that project that was about having a 3D model. There are actually companies now in Oman that do 3D modeling. Some of them do use drones, some they don't. So that would be the niche for the, you know, younger generation to exploit, going to that direction where they use drones to do 3D reconstruction. They can use drones to provide other kind of services. So really, I see that drones, it has many, many potentials, and we only know few of them. The third technology it's the IoT part. I am aware at least of one company which is based basically on IoT. Unfortunately, I can't recall the name. If I do at some point, I'll say it. So IoT, it's already been an interest for several entities, DM or Mantle. They're interested in IoT. So one business model would be is that you offer companies the network along with data processing. And that would be very interesting because the company doesn't have to worry about the infrastructure. You already have the infrastructure. Would you just tell them that I can use that infrastructure to collect data about your processes, do some processing and data analytics, and then I give you the trends and knowledge. And that would be very appealing because the company doesn't have to invest in any capital. It's only paying you for service. So these are the three main technologies which I believe they're very relevant. They have potentials, not far in the future. I would say, the current generation that we have, the young generation, they can invest in and they can open up companies in that direction. I hope I answered your question, Dr. Ahmed.
Thank you, doctor.
We have another questions from Dr. Abdullah Al-Azri. If you can, yes.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Dr. Al-Jamia. Thank you very much for the presentation. I have two questions. From your viewpoint, what do you think about the current support in Oman overall you got from the stakeholders? And what are the main IR4 projects that Oman as a government should focus in? Thanks.
Thank you, Abdullah. So with regard to the first question, the kind of support, the sponsors that we have worked with and some of the entities, they were very supportive. The issue is sometimes you might face some obstacles because this is new to them. So whenever you say, I want to fly a drone to collect information, that would be like raising a red flag for some of the entities. Why you want to fly a drone? What are you going to do with this drone? Because something new. So you'll see this kind of resistance from time to time. Same thing when you ask for, we would like to do some big data analytics. So if you can give us access to your logs, we can use them for training set. Once we train it, we get some trends, we can give it back to you. And then we get some opposition because for them, why do you want our log? What are you going to do with it? Even though those logs have been there in disks, collecting dust for years and years, nobody's even, looking at them. But it's always this, these concerns that what you're going to do with this technology. So I guess this will take time. People will get used to drones, machine learning, the need for access to data. I think that will take some time. Other than that, the entities that I've listed in the acknowledgement, they were very supportive. They really want to invest in these projects because they really want to invest in the community. As far as the IR4 projects, as I mentioned in the first few slides, IR4, it's not really one thing, it's multiple things. So ideally, you want to invest in everything. But given the current situation where you are very limited when it comes to funding, you really have to look for certain niches. Things that doesn't really cost much. The learning curve is not that is not that hard, and you can make quick wins. Because once you make quick wins, that will basically encourage others, and then the snowball will start to go bigger and bigger. That's why I mentioned that technologies such as UVS, unmanned vehicle system drones, in specific. IoT and big data, they are really easy to work with. Okay, when I say easy, I shouldn't really, because this is recorded, people will think when I say easy, it's piece of cake easy. No, it's not. What I'm trying to say here is that 10 years ago, those technology would be very, very difficult to work with. Currently, they are easier to work with. You have simulation tools, emulation tools, you have plethora of different resources that give you access to how to work with these technologies. So now it becomes easier to work with. So these three technologies, if you can invest in, they can give you quick wins, doesn't really require a lot of, you know, investment. And once you have that, that will encourage the private sector to work more on similar technologies. Again, ideally, you want to, you know, invest in everything, but to be practical, I think you need to pick the technologies which are pretty much needed, and they don't cost much when it comes to the capital expenditure. I hope I answered your question, Abdullah.
Thank you very much, Doctor. Thanks. Yes, you did.
Thank you, Doctor. Due to the two constraints of the time that we've got, a quick question asked from the chat room regarding handling. How did you handle the detection in wildlife projects while capturing images, and was there any baseline accuracy?
Yeah. So the way we did it, of course, all of this was done, you know, in coordination with the Office for Conservation of Environment. So we didn't just break in; it was a coordinated effort. Initially, when we launched the drone, especially the gazelles, they basically get startled and they run away. We just want them to, you know, remain fixed in one location because we need images. We wanted images where the gazelles are stationary, other images where they are moving. The problem is gazelles wouldn't stop moving, right? Whenever the drone approaches, they would just, you know, fled away. But after some time, the gazelles got used to the drone to be in the area. And that was a relief to us because we thought that this would basically screw up our experiment. So we were able to maintain certain attitudes. The purpose is you want to take imagery, but you don't want to disturb the wildlife. So you have to maintain a certain altitude. The images that we take in no ways will disturb the environment. At least that's what we try to do. Once we have all these images, we brought them back to the lab, and then we train that, neural network that I spoke about. If you're interested, you can use, there are several tools that are available there. I know that many like to use a TensorFlow, but for this particular project, we use Darknet complemented with YOLO. And that really gave us, very accurate results. And the way we calculate the accuracy, we split the, like in any machine vision project, we split the data set into two sets, one for training and one for testing. The training was, further split into training and validation. And in the testing images, we know what is the accurate number of animals and their location. So after training, we give we do the training, we take the classifier, and then we do the recognition, and then we manually check whether the detected animal was in the right location and we have the right number of animals. Okay, and it's not only detecting the animal, but you have to recognize the is it gazelle, it is donkey, is it something else. And based on that, we were able to find the baseline. And if I recall, I think it was, I have to go back to the report, but I think it's 96, 97% accuracy. Now, it doesn't mean that it always be 96, 97. We were doing this in the daylight. This was back in July last year. So it was pretty sunny. It was an ideal, ideal environment to do recognition. What if things change? What if it is cloudy? Would that change the accuracy? So more tests has to be done. I hope I answered the question.
Thank you, Doctor, for your enlightenment. Just a last and quick question from Rafa Shindra. So if you can unmute yourself and the mic is yours, Mr. Rafa Shindra.
Dr. Ahmed, can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Yes, I can. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. The lecture presentation was very useful for us, right? Because many of us are currently working in the unmanned vehicle systems in our college. So I'd like to ask you a few questions based on that, right? We are actually developing an autonomous rover, and we are also developing an autonomous drone for detecting locust swarms. So is there any specifics available for unmanned vehicles especially drones which can utilize this AI. And the second question is like, is there any specific local requirement for Oman with respect to unmanned vehicle systems so that we people can start working on such projects? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ravichandra. So with regard to the tools, in the first couple of projects that I've gone through in my presentation, we used ROS, R-O-S. And ROS, it comes with so many tools within. So ROS is basically a Linux software, a Linux operating system. And it's basically an Ubuntu distribution, if you are familiar with this. So it's an Ubuntu distribution. They have tweaked it. They have many tools and software. And within, you have Gazebo. And the Gazebo allows you to model unmanned vehicle systems. So the drone that I've shown in that simulation, that was actually modeled, wasn't there. So we have modeled the drone. We have actually modeled also a ground unmanned robot. We also modeled in that. So it's pretty useful. The learning curve for the Gazebo, it takes time. So that would be the challenging part. Other than that, it's something that the students can work on and you know, they can do fantastic stuff with. When it comes to the entities who is responsible, that wasn't really clear for me. If you're asking about who can regulate, so if you want to, for example, to get a permit to fly a drone, you have to make a request to CEA, PACA previously, and CEA will do the coordination with NSA, National Survey Agency, I think, or Authority, sorry, National Survey Authority, Hayat Masaha, as well as with the air traffic control. And after that, they will give you the permit so that you can fly the drone. If your question was, is there any entity who is, you know, specialized in researching in unmanned vehicle systems? There isn't really explicitly, but the Ministry of Higher Education, Research and Innovation, after it has been restructured with the decree last year, now it has all the research component, including EJAD. So those would be the entity who will be interested in advancing IR4 unmanned vehicle systems in particular. I hope I answered your question, Mr. Ravichandra.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. For your enlightenment. The University of Technology and Applied Science, Nizwa, expresses its gratitude and thanks for sharing your knowledge and skills with us. Thank you very much, Dr. Ahmed. Now we are going to...
Thank you.
Thank you, my dear. Thank you. Now we are moving to the second technical talk. The second keynote speaker is Dr. Abdullah Al-Hassanat, Chairman of the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering at University of Nizwa. Dr. Al-Hassanat received the Bachelor and Master degree in Computer Engineering from Jordan University of Science and Technology Jordan in 2004-2007, respectively. His PhD degree in Wireless Network from the University of Newcastle in UK, 2012. He is an Associate Professor in Computer Engineering at Al-Hassanat bin Al-Hussein bin Talal University, Jordan. Since 2018, Dr. Al-Hassanat is the chairman of the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering at Nizwa University. He has authored more than 40 papers in high quality scientific journals and international conferences. His main research interests, including Internet of Things technologies, 5G, 6G, and beyond technologies. He's also interested in artificial intelligence, machine learning, and computer vision techniques. Dr. Al-Hassanat will share his thoughts and experiences on the Internet of Things application challenges and trends. Dr. Abdullah Al-Hassanat, welcome you. The floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Dr. Majdi, for this introduction. And actually, let me express my sincere thanks to the University of Technology and Applied Science for this invitation to be being with you, sharing my humble experience in the IoT, and being with you, my colleagues, to see some technology advancement in the IoT. Also, I will try to project that on Oman and how much we can take benefit from that one. So can you see my screen? I think Is it clear?
Yes, it is clear. Go ahead, please.
So our today's topic will be in IoT trends and challenging. Today I will speak about the most trends and expectations from the IoT within the next 2 or 3 years. Also, I will focus the light on the IoT challenging issue. I will go maybe a bit details in the some technology that make the change and pave the way for the Internet of Things to realize the expectations. And also I will put the light a little bit on the IoT in Oman. Then I will list some open research related to our contributions in the IoT. The IoT actually is defined as connecting things to the internet. Things may include objects related to people or objects related to physical environments. So based on the Cisco statistic, in 2012, this was in 2012, in 2003, there were less than one device connected to the internet per people or per a person. However, in 2008, the number of connected devices has been increased to be more than one device per person. And from here, IoT has been appeared. As Dr. Ahmed in the previous talk, he said that the fourth industrial revolution, it is actually about data and IoT technology. So that after that, in 2020 is what it was expected. That will be about seven devices connected to the internet per person. But this expectation has been actually changed. According to Cisco, connecting devices to the internet, it is not just actually devices, it is actually connecting data and processes to the internet. So that Internet of Everything now has been introduced by Cisco, aiming to create new capabilities, richer experience, and unprecedented economic opportunity for businesses, individuals, countries, and bring all of these together for people, processes, and data. So that this model has been introduced by Cisco, how in addition to connected people to the internet in more relevant and valuable ways, also things will be connected to the internet, processes will be also connected to the internet, and data as well to for making decisions and be applicable for our realities. So in this case, the expectation has been changed now, and based on the statistic in 2021, the expectation is it is that in 2025 we will have about 75 billion devices connected to the internet, billion components connected to the internet at the same time. So that this is actually a big challenge for the infrastructures, how to handle such a huge number of connected devices. This as well actually open a huge gates for applications, so that in the near future it is expected that IoT will significantly contribute to the overall quality of our life and change actually our life. Now we start see how our life is changing, but it will be significantly changed within the 2 or 3 years in the future. So that smart home will be enable remote control for home appliances, such as garage can be automatically opened. Also coffee can be prepared. Temperature can be set before reaching home. So what impact the IoT on the economy that we have? As you can see here, the overall economic impact is expected to be in the range between $2.7 to $6.2 trillion in 2025. And most of this investment will go to the healthcare applications, where 40% will be invested in the healthcare applications. After that, manufacturing is coming with about 32%. So it is expected for the manufacturing that, especially let us take example for the vehicles, autonomous vehicle systems, it is expected in 2025 about 75% of the vehicles will be connected to the internet. How it works, basically, it consists of sensors. The sensors are collecting data from the environment, then collected this information and sent them to the access point. The access point will be forward this data to the cloud computers, say, or servers or whatever, and this cloud computing will process the data in more valuable way and give it to the customers, to the users, using their interfaces such as mobiles, website, for example, or servers. What does that require from us, actually, and from the technology to be changed, actually to adopt and to handle such Zoom? In the sense of, for example, sensing technology, embedded systems and microcontroller technology are taking place for connectivity. Like we have personal area network, body area networks, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, ZigBee, as well as 5G, 6G generations. For data processing, data analysis, fog computing and cloud computing will take place as well. And after that, as you know, for the user interface, mobile application, web page, and as well as servers. So that I will focus in this presentation on the multiple access techniques and how a huge number of users actually can be connected to the internet at the same time. This is the more challenging issue here. Connecting a huge number of users will actually lead us to the vast amount of data. And then if we have such an amount of data, then malicious and attackers will be there as well. So that considering a huge number of users, multiple access techniques should be developed in a way to realize the expectations. Vast amount of data, which it is expected to exceed more than 100 zettabytes, so that we should be ready for such amount of data. Security and privacy also should be, it's another concern here, and a lot of work has been done for security in IoT. So in this presentation, actually, I will focus a little bit about multiple access techniques and how this actually handled. I will try to simplify the concept as much as I can, starting by the mobile network evolutions. As you know, currently we are now hearing a lot about the 5G mobile generations, but actually this is coming after a lot of generations, starting from the first G, then second G, third G, and so on. So for every generation, it's about 10 years to have a new generation. And from generation to generation, there is a new technology, and as well as there is an impact in the industry, as you can see. So the significant impact, as you can see in the fifth G, where autonomous vehicles, edge computings, and smartphones are taking place. The most three important scenarios in the fifth G are actually the data rate, how to improve data rate. And this is regarding how to speed up our communications. And then the number of devices connected to the internet at the same time, which is very important actually, as well as the latency. And one of the goal is to make the latency as be to zero. So that this is very important expectations. And it is worth mentioning that not all 5G functionality will be available immediately. So that, yes, we are speaking about 5G, but not all the functionality or not all the expectation are currently available here. So in fact, a sequence of releases already exist. For example, release 15 now exists in 2019, which focus on data rate only. In releases 16 and 17, they will support the two remaining scenarios, such as the latency as well as the number of users connected to the internet. Here you can see the 5G worldwide map, where it focuses on the North America, Europe, some of that will be in the Middle East. And if we take our case here in Sultanate of Oman, the full functionality, we cannot see that full functionality, but the most functionality of the fifth generation is focused on Muscat. Here we have something in Suhar as well as in Dhofar. Also, there are another 5G functionality provided elsewhere here in Oman, but it cannot be seen here because the shaded 5G. What is shown here is the most functionality provided by this map, right? So, as I told you, we will focus on the multiple access techniques, and I will only mention two techniques, and these techniques have changed the face of Internet of Things technology. So that the first one will be non-orthogonal multiple access technique, and the second one will be spectrum sharing technique. Starting with the NOMA, which is non-orthogonal multiple access techniques. And as you know, maybe in all mobile generations, such as the second generation and the third generation, we have OMA. OMA, it is like orthogonal multiple access. And in this technology, the channel is divided on the current user so that it can be divided based on time. So we call it TDMA, or it can be divided based on frequency. As you know, we can call it FDMA, or can hybrid between these parameters. At the end of the day, the channel should be divided so that if we have a lot of users, the channel would be divided and the service would be significantly affected. So if you look to the 5G and 6G and BIAN technology as well, we have NOMA. NOMA actually said that all users can share the same channel resources so that they can use the full bandwidth. They can connect to the access point at any time. And this is the key idea about the NOMA. And if you compare it with OMA, actually, as you can see here, more specifically, time will be divided upon users, or frequency could be also divided. Here in NOMA, the full bandwidth is actually given to all users. But the difference here, as you can see, the power allocated to each user here is different. And this difference actually is coming from different user had different distance from access point. So I don't need to allocate same power to all users. I can allocate specific power based on their distance from the access point. And this is the key idea behind NOMA and why it works successfully. And in this case, we can connect a lot of users without impacting the data rate or without impacting any delay or latency. The other technique is actually spectrum sharing technique. Spectrum sharing technology represents promising technology for the 5G, where user can use any free spectrums. Even the spectrum is not formally assigned to him. So that, like Omantel, user can use, for example, Orib carrier, or we can use other techniques. We will see an example later on. So that one of the most important technology in the spectrum sharing one is the cognitive technology. Cognitive radio networks is an intelligent radio that can be programmed and configured dynamically. It is user device are assigned to use the best wireless channel exist nearby. So consider such an example. We have a user who is with Oman Tel carrier and want to use the channel, but the corresponding access point or mobile station is full for him. So according to the cognitive radio networks, this user will consider as a secondary user for another carrier, such as Orido. And he will be allowed to use this carrier as long as the primary user has not been affected. So we give priority to the primary user. And if the primary user is ideal, is not using the channel, we can give it to another one, even if it's from different carriers. This concept has been extended not only between mobile carriers. It also can be within all the spectrums in the space, so that such example show us how these mobile users are getting crowded because they have assigned frequencies and they cannot use other spectrum. Now with cognitive radio network, they can use different spectrums as the spectrum allow them to use, and they have to be smart enough to negotiate and then select the best route for them. In this case, we have unlimited internet access, and this is actually, without this, we cannot achieve the ultimate target of IoT and the fourth industrial revolution. Now, even what we have seen actually from these technologies and from this advancement, but still, if there is no cell-less network, then the smart city cannot be applied. So what we mean by cell-less network, that means everybody, every service every user and component in the city. He can get benefit from the network, he can connect it at any time, and he can provide his service at any time. So that smart universities, smart building, smart monitoring as well, autonomous vehicles, all of them can be connected to the same infrastructures. And these infrastructures actually supported with the technologies, along with other technologies, it can be done and we can achieve the smart city. Right now, there are around 30 billion of connected devices, as you have seen. But in 2025, this number is expected to be increased to 75 billion. So this massive boost in the number of IoT connected devices doesn't come without any consequences. So that being connected to the internet with many devices, maybe your computer, your mobile phones, your vehicles, your home, all of them are connected to the internet. What about your privacy? So that is your IoT device safe and secure? This is another concern in the IoT security issues. I give you only two examples to see how much it is important. Former US Vice President Dick Cheney's doctor disabled his pacemaker. Why doctor disabled his pacemaker? Because doctor feared terrorists could hack and attack Cheney Hearts and kill him. Yes, what they have did, they have stopped wireless access to this device. But also they have stopped another benefits, such as accessing and monitoring this device. So it is very important. It could cause loss of life sometimes with the presence of the attackers. Another example, in 2016, maybe you have heard about Dyn attack. Actually, Dyn is a DNS provider in USA. It supported millions of websites. There were attack on this Dyn server, and the attack was launched by IoT specific group, which led to about 8% of loss of its customers. And this is actually caused loss of economic as well. So actually security is very important. But actually in IoT, devices are resource constrained. Are very resource constraints. They are energy limited because they are battery powered devices. They have short communication range because they are using local communication such as Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and Zigbee. And they have even low processing capabilities like embedded system. Implementing conventional security measures to secure IoT devices like cryptographic techniques is not always visible. So we cannot apply the normal technique that we are using in our laptops and our mobile phones. Okay, so that in this case, more focus will be on cyber securities, especially physical layer securities. Special layer security provides lightweight securities because it is using the physical channel like frequency, time, location, and so on to secure the IoT device. So it is more visible to be used in IoT. A lot of work and research has been done in this way. So you can see here the money spending worldwide in the security. It is expected to reach more than 4 billion in 2022, while it was about 700 million in 2017. So there is a rapid actually increase in the money spending in this field. Now, yes, IoT provide full connectivity, but what if disaster happens? What if there is no internet or no network coverage so that the basic functionality should not be interrupted? And I focus here, the basic functionality should be continue to provide service to those people who need it, especially in emergency cases. What is the solution here? I give you also another alternative to the IoT if in case there is a disaster and the IoT device is not connected, it is the mobile opportunistic network. And it is a new field, very interesting one. And why it is working? Because more than 3.5 5 billion people worldwide use smart mobile phones. In Oman, for example, there are more than 6 million people, they are using smartphones. And most of these smartphones are integrated with Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and so on. These smartphones have also many advanced hardware and software applications, like GPS and social network. All of them can be integrated and utilized in such cases. I give you here a scenario where mobile opportunistic network can be utilized in disasters so that local communication between people can be done, can be forwarded maybe in multi-hub way to the concerned people, to the authorized people to make the help. And local communication, I mean like Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, the available communications without the knowledge of these people. No need for these people to know if there is any help, but actually between the mobile itself, they should have special agreements to use such applications. Another applications, it is e-health monitoring, and it is very interesting one. For example, how to stay safe so that you can monitor areas surrounding you. And this area may be covered by Wi-Fi that you are running. And you can detect people are surrounding you if they are vaccinated people or infected people or not vaccinated people, and so on, so that you can collect some information about nearby peoples using local communications. And this, again, application need pre-acceptance to run this program, and so on. And security, actually, again, it is very important here. Now we come to Sultanate of Oman, which is actually which has a bright IoT futures, as Dr. Ahmed highlighted some of these applications, and also I will highlight another applications as well. So it can be distinguished from my point of view. I think Oman can be distinguished in many practical fields where IoT technology can be very useful. And why I said distinguished? Because Oman is special in, for example, in climate. Based on its geographical locations, Oman is highly susceptible to many natural disasters, such as flooding, tornadoes, hurricanes, and so on. And I have listed here, just for your knowledge, some recent disasters happened from 2007 to 2018. Like here, IoT emergency and survival system are very helpful. Another specialty for Oman is actually the geology. Geology, Oman has actually very complex geology. It has, you know, variety of mountains, wadis, deserts, and sea. So yes, this make this country very attractive for tourism from all the world, but actually network connectivity is another problem here, especially in wadis and mountains. And this should be, you know, taken another consideration. So I focus here the light on our last project. We are working with Al Hussein bin Talal University, with the and as well as the University of Nizwa. The project was focused on index modulation approach for decision gathering in IoT applications. And this project actually focused on how to reduce the number of transmitted data, number of transmitted decisions to the access point, so that reducing power consumptions as well as increasing data rate and reducing decision error rate as well. And it has been, alhamdulillah, finished and successful with many published paper in high quality journals. Also, I would like to give you just a sample of one of our student projects last year. It is the iSurvival project, which is supported by Ministry of Higher Education under FORAB project. And the main idea of this project is to have intelligent assembly points distributed so that this, as well as sensor nodes, applications, and access point and Zigbee coordinators. So in case of flooding, there are information need to be sent to the Zigbee in order to inform people who have the applications. Now the people will be collected to the nearest and safest assembly point according to the applications. After that, the assembly point will send information to the ZigB coordinator in order to inform the consent and authorize people to start rescuing and do the necessary for trapped people, for example, or collected people at the assembly points. This project has been, as I told you, done at the University of Nizwa and implemented at, as you know, a case study. Why I mentioned this, actually, I would like to again highlight the point raised in the previous talk. It is now the fourth generation is accessible by everyone. So it is not like previous industrial revolution. Students, they can work at home. We can work very easy. They are accessible because most of them, they are open access and open source application, so that it is easy. What we need, actually, we need intentions and we need motivation, and as well as we need to encourage students to go in these projects and to be involved in IoT technologies. I come to the final slide, which is just list some concluding remark. IoT is definitely a big deal, and it is going to get bigger with the passage of time. Sadly, the bigger it gets, the more target it has on its back. All the combining IoT challenges and trends will get bigger as well. Right, so manufacturers and other linked with the IoT industry will have to get serious about security issues and threats. And finally, Oman has a bright IoT future and can be distinguished in many practical fields where IoT technology can be utilized and can be very useful. Thank you so much for your listening, and you are welcome for any question.
Thank you very much, Dr. Abdullah Hassanat.
Thank you so much.
If you can please, before we proceed to stop sharing the.
Yes.
Thank you very much, Dr. Abdullah Hassanat, for your remarkable speech in the new era of Internet of Things. We are inspired from your speech about the multiple access techniques, how data is handled when it is huge, yes, and its security concerns. I believe all parties will got benefited from it. Thank you very much, Dr. Hassanat. We will start now with the QA sessions, and we've got some numbers of attendees who raised their hands. So we will start with Mr. Muhammad Alim. The mic is yours. Mr. Muhammad Alim.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Thank you very much, Doctor, for your informative presentation on IoT. I have just one concern regarding, apart from the security issue that you have been discussing in your presentation, and that is regarding the interoperability with the present network. Like, IoT is a new technology completely, and we have a traditional technology which is throughout the country, not only in Oman, throughout the world. How the IoT, yes, is going to cope up or interoperate with this old technology when the new sensors and the new network is going to come up? This is one thing. And the second thing regarding the bandwidth. As you said, jitabytes, and it is a lot of things that is going to upload on the centralized servers. So how we are going to cope up with the bandwidth that we have at present? Will it be means feasible in the coming duration? So these are the two questions. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Muhammad, for your questions. And I think your first question is about how to integrate different hardware and communication protocol, because we have old technology and now we have a new technology. I would like to bring to your attention that always the transition is in technology is done in a smooth way, and there is agreements between companies and so on, so that you cannot jump directly to the new technology before have some compatible in between the new and old technologies, so that we can move in a smooth transitions. And this is very important technology. It is very important point that you have mentioned. We are speaking about completely new technology. Yes, we are speaking about completely new technology, but this as well, it should support somehow for sometimes the old technology until it has been, you know, replaced completely by the new ones. I give you example now. In Oman, for example, we have 3G, we have 3.5G mobile generation, as we have 5G. All of them are running. And do you know that 5G need different access points? It cannot be done with the normal access point that we are using. And even 5G need a new mobile hardware. So your old mobile cannot run 5G. So that what has been done? Now you buy a mobile, you work with 3.5 and 4, and then after 2 years you replace it until we have completely changed the infrastructures and so on. So that it is a smooth transition. About the second question, it is a bandwidth. Yes, actually it is a big challenge. And they are now speaking about broadband wireless communications. What we have now is broadband fiber optic communication at our homes. And what about broadband wireless? Sometimes we are speaking about satellite communications. And as I told you, what I have given to you actually focusing on access point, but not on data rate. In data rate, there are also a huge work has been done currently in order to increase the bandwidth and to allow the user to use the full bandwidth. One of these technologies, as I told you, the NOMA technology, which allows the user to use the full bandwidth without any restrictions. I hope I have answered your question.
Thank you, Dr. Abdullah. And the last question we can take from Dr. Vimal. Dr. Vimal, are you available? So we can move on to the third person.
I'm available, sir. Dr. Abdullah, really, I thank you so much for on behalf of UTAS-Nizwa for presenting a wonderful idea regarding the IoT application. I would like to ask two questions. As I belong to electrical engineering, I have some basic questions related with this IoT technology. Is there any proven method with respect to safeguarding the data stored in the cloud? Because in IoT technology, we rely mostly on storing the data in the cloud and access from that. That is question number one. And number two is network congestion. So first we design a system considering a fixed amount of population. Later there happens some increase in number of people that may use this technology in future. How to handle these kind of situations, sir?
Uh-huh. Thank you so much, Doctor. About your first question is how to manage data storage or data communication to the cloud server. Again, this is about between access point, and we have to understand first that we have many communication phases in the IoT. The first phase between sensor and the access point, and this can be done like Zigbee or Wi-Fi communication, and this is very simple. Now, the most technology focus on how to improve the communication technology between access point and the cloud server. So that this is the most important part. And as you said, we have a huge of data and we have to send this data to the cloud server so that people are working on this research. And one of the main scenarios in the 5G is to improve data rate in this scenario. So that I think, this is the first one. And the second question is regarding the congestion. Congestion, that means multiple access techniques. So that, again, as I told you before, in the cognitive radio networks, it is the solution. And if, I mean, you can use the full networks without respect to any frequency that you are using. Congestion, that means you are connected at one time at a specific frequency, so that another one, another one is also using the same frequency at the same time, so there will be a problem. So in this case, what happens in cognitive radio networks? The access point will send only one signal, and as you electrical engineer, so I think you will understand this point. The access point will send only one signal to all users, and every user will take his part of the signals. So this is what we said, NOMA technology. That is, there is only one signal to all, and this signal contain everything. I don't need to send multiple signals, multiple to make congestion. So there is no congestion. It is only one signal, and every user has to take his part according to his power allocated based on his distance from the access point. So this is the basic concept of the NOMA technology. And it has actually a great effort and research has been done. And it is one of the interesting areas that you can work on.
Thank you, Doctor. The University of Technology and Applied Science, NIZWA, expresses its gratitude and thanks for sharing your knowledge and skills with us. So thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Dr. Majid. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Now, last but not least, the third speaker for this event is Dr. Shamanan Jacob, researcher and lecturer at the Engineering Department, UTAS-Nizwa. Shamanan Jacob acquired the Bachelor, Master, and PhD degree in Computer Science and Engineering in India. Her interest always steered towards interdisciplinary areas of research that placed focus on utilizing computational thinking and technological advancement across diverse fields such as medicine, finance management, and social network analysis. She was the recipient of the Young Scientist Early Career Research Award from the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, 2016. She was sponsored by the Government of Tamil Nadu in 2009 to deliver online tutoring that would enable underprivileged students to get access to the programming and latest trends in computer science. Dr. Shamanan, we welcome you, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, sir. A very good morning to one and all present here. I wish to place on record my thanks to the Dean, UTAS-Nizwa, Assistant Dean, Head of Department Engineering, and for the organizing team of this UTAS Research Webinar Series for having given me this opportunity. I wish to thank all my senior faculty, my colleagues, teaching and non-teaching staff, my family and friends for having given me all the support and encouragement thus far. On this note, I would like to begin my presentation on the topic, Confluence of Cyber-Physical Systems in Academia and Oman, the process of integrating 4IR technologies for smart education. The agenda of my presentation today will cover a prelude to what exactly is smart education, what are cyber-physical systems, how they can be integrated with academia, what are the 4IR technologies that play a key role in enhancing the current state of education in Oman and the world at large, the challenges and opportunities that are available for researchers and academicians. Anything that is IT-enabled is said to be smart. I would like to rephrase it as anything that is IoT-enabled is currently smart. When it comes to the field of education, it can be viewed from three perspectives, from the educational outcomes, the ICT components, and the organizational dimensions. I would detail on the ICT components in the future slides. When it comes to educational outcomes, it focuses on the development or reinvention of the pedagogy, the curriculum and syllabi. So the components of IoT can be used not only to train the students, but IoT needs to be used as an artifact where students can use the IoT tools to acquire their skills. So why do we actually need the smart education to enhance tutor versatility, student engagement and collaboration while learning? By making our presentations, our teaching learning methodologies more interactive and visually appealing. These are the main targets of enhancing our current state of education to a smart learning environment. So what is a cyber-physical system? On paper, in the latest research on 4IR technologies, one researcher noted the cyber-physical systems to be the backbone of the fourth industrial revolution. By definition, it is a computer system which is controlled by computer algorithms. And it is defined as the confluence of cybernetics, mechatronics, and design science. Each of these fields is defined to achieve a special target by the use of sensors, artificial intelligence, and AI at its core. So when you say AI, AI tools, AI solutions, what do these actually target? Cyber-physical systems mainly comprise of a cyber and physical space, which make use of sensors to gather signals from the environment, process them using computer algorithms, and finally move the actuators to rotate the devices. I have mentioned a few examples here of which I would like to talk about pilot avionics, which is a combination of electronics and aviation science. This is when an aeroplane is in the autopilot control mode. And it is being monitored by a pilot, but it automatically, the sensors placed in the air flight automatically gather the signals from the environment, the obstacles in the runway, whether the runway is free, the environmental conditions, the presence of a turbulence, and they feed it to a computer in the plane, which processes these signals and decides whether the parameters are within the allowable range, and they automatically start or land the flight. In case of any diversions, the pilot takes over. So what do these cyber-physical systems mean to the current state of education or academia in Oman? Now, this is a very familiar situation which we witness almost twice every semester, the online assessments. So we have all these facilities already in place. We have a Microsoft Stream server, we have our audio and microphones, the video recordings, everything is available. So which is the cyber-physical system here? Anything that is tangible is physical. Human beings form a part of the cyber-physical system. Our machines and devices form a part of the cyber-physical system. So what is the cyberspace that we currently have? It is the high-speed bandwidth and Wi-Fi, which is enabling us to store all these video recordings for future usage. We have the server, which is able to store the data. We have the internet, which is able to make these recordings. So what enhancement can be done to this current situation? It is this deep learning model which needs to be incorporated. So what does deep learning have to do here? What does machine learning at its core have to do here? Right now, when we have these video recordings, we need our tutors or human entities to go through the recordings to identify any kind of abnormal or suspicious activity on the part of the student. So when deep learning or automated systems come into picture, it is when these kind of recordings are recorded in the server over a period of time. And our machine learning algorithms, whichever one we may use, are trained to study these recordings. And we first train the system on what is to be classified as a suspicious activity: blurring of the camera, student moving away from a system, frequent on and off of his login. Whatever it may be, we are supposed to train our algorithms on that. So in future, when these recordings are fed into the automated system, it will automatically detect whether the student is suspicious or not. In such a case, does it eradicate the need for tutors? Not at all. It can be used as a recommender system, which will ease out the process of detecting suspicious activity. Not only that, it reduces the bandwidth for storage. We don't have to store the entire 2-hour recording of our videos, but only those video frames which are automatically detected by a machine learning algorithm. So it saves space, it saves time, as well as it makes our job quicker and faster, which is all the smart world is about. So what other features of cyber-physical system can enhance academia? Automatic student ID recognition. So now we need the student to show his ID card, and the tutors have to look through the cameras to check whether the ID matches with the records that they have. So when the student ID is automatically loaded into a server and he's able to show his ID card, which is automatically taken by the system using image processing, OCR, it extracts his name and his ID and is able to match it with the database. That is an automated system. So by doing that, we are not just reducing the work or the workload on the tutor, but rather we are giving some responsibility to the student who's able to acknowledge that he needs to have a good camera, the proper ID card, and the resources to make himself available for the exam. Because now sometimes it is just that it is blurred, so it's difficult for us to see. So this enforces a kind of responsibility on the student community also to be well prepared for the exams, and they get tuned to the smart environment. This is a paper not yet published, which was just in press in April 2021. So these are all the 4IR technologies that have been reviewed in literature in the IEEE Explore. So I would just like to highlight on what the 4IR technologies mean to the smart educational system and the smart learning environment. So smart educational system, educational CPS, smart learning environment are all terms that are used interchangeably in the literature. So right now, these are the four perspectives that we are aiming at while incorporating it into academia. E-learning is already at a good pace in our institutes. We have the Moodle server, we have 24/7 access, high-speed Wi-Fi enabled campuses. So what more can be added to the current state of e-learning? We have the IoT artifacts, which we are using to access our e-learning resources. What about virtual reality? Virtual reality gives the student the impression that he's already working in a lab, which is enabled by IT. He doesn't get the feeling that he's at home or in his workplace. So is it possible, or are we having knowledge, and are we competent enough to use the virtual reality software where we train our students to use the same to acquire his skills, where he will be later eligible to work as a skilled workforce in the smart world? Robotics is comprising of completely mechanical devices, which requires the student to come to the institute and work as of now. What about robotic simulation software? Is it available? Are we able to provide it to our students, where even though we are geographically distributed, they would get the impression that they are working in a real-time environment? That is what the real-world context really means to smart education. Coming to personalized learning, learning analytics, and big data, all the three are intertwined. Personalized learning is where you adapt your education system to the individual needs of every student. So for that, we need to first collect the student preferences, health status, his special skills, his interests, his learning capacity, and so on. So just think about what a vast database it would form if we are going to collect all these details about every student, feed it to a machine learning algorithm, make it study the preferences of those students, identify what kind of special learning teaching methodologies or interdisciplinary courses can be given to that particular student according to his interest, according to what he wants to become, according to his previous grades. So all this is now being done by the tutors. If it is made into a recommender system by the use of machine learning, deep learning networks, it is a completely smart environment. So when we are coming here to this personalized learning, then comes the research opportunity for storage. So we had our previous two speakers also talk about data being part of the 4IR. So what are we going to do with this data? Computer science has a solution in terms of two technologies, learning analytics and big data. Learning analytics is where you're going to process the data and store the data. We have the cloud servers. We have our blockchain technology. We have distributed computing. Blockchain is heaven on earth when it comes to research because it almost offers you everything that any researcher would want. Unanimity, anonymity, security, distribution, scalability, everything is available in blockchain technology. But how are we going to implement it in our educational system? Do we have the software and the resources, the competence to work with the blockchain technologies, whereby we can store the student data across semesters, process them using machine learning algorithms, develop a recommender system where we will be able to identify how to handle misbehaving students, how to handle special students, students who are exceptionally good, what kind of interdisciplinary courses or skills can we tutor to them as well as make them more competent to the smarter world. Distributed computing is where we spread data across multiple servers and we try to process them independently and then bring it to a classified output. So the research issues that come there are, on what basis do we distribute the data? How many servers do we need? What about data consistency, data synchronization across all these servers? Who's going to decide whether your final output is valid or not? All these research issues have to be identified by us tutors, have to be solved by us with the help of our students, which will enable them also to have an idea of what IoT, data storage, data analysis, and machine learning means to a smarter world and a smarter education system. So we are talking about the four industrial revolutions. When it comes to education, Dr. Muhammad Ali in the Commonwealth of Learning in 2020 called it as the fourth education revolution, which does not just involve making changes to the current system of education, but rather reinventing it as a whole. So when you say reinventing it as a whole, it starts from the basic inclusion of IoT artifacts, IoT components in the system of teaching and learning, the pedagogical approaches, the curriculum, and the reinvention of the syllabi and the outcomes as well. The current educational system in Oman basically comprises of e-learning, mentoring, outcome-based education, OERs, and Wi-Fi-enabled campuses. So we are just looking, we are already on par with the surge of 4IR technologies, and we're just looking at how to bring them into an enhancement with the deep learning and deep neural networks. How these deep neural networks can be enforced into the current educational system to make a smart learning environment. I have already spoken about these technical challenges of storage, data security. So what is prudent implementation of technology? As someone rightly said, technology is not good or bad. It's what we make of it that makes the difference. So we all know that when a student is trained in technology, there are some negative effects as well. They begin to find loopholes in evading the best practices. So how are we going to handle such kind of loopholes? How much freedom are we going to give the tutor as well as the student? Just because there's a surge of technologies, it does not mean it can be implemented at the same time, we have to be very prudent in what kind of technologies, at what level, with what level of freedom are we going to allow both the tutors and students to be a part of in order to avoid security breaches and data leaks. Managing trade-offs is basically all the research components that come into when we are implementing these 4IR technologies. What is the cost involved? Time, the resources in terms of people. How are we going to manage it? Till what level and what stage are we going to implement it? What is the security for the data storage? What is the security for the data access and processing? All these are technical challenges which are open to us academicians and researchers. So in conclusion, I would like to say that this is the final educational cyber-physical system that we are looking at, which researchers call as a 3E4C based education, where tutors' role is to explain and enable students to communicate the same way in a better capacity. And it is the job of the tutors to exploit the student knowledge by giving the right kind of assessments. So even in the assessments, if you wish to integrate CPS, it is where you alter the questions according to each student's capability. Based on the previous question that he answered, you raise the difficulty of the next question. So the question level is totally different across students. This has already been implemented in the graduate record examinations, which is the admission process for higher education in the United States. So every student gets a different question based on how he has answered the previous question. So this is where we have the recommender systems and deep learning networks or machine learning to alter our current state of online assessments. Exploration is where we enable the student to start his research-based and lifelong learning, where without tutor assistance, he's able to solve a problem independently. So as I've spoken a lot about machine learning, I thought these are two open source web-based software where students can don't need any software knowledge. They can just go to the browser like we're using Google Chrome and they can work out with these machine learning models and practice their AI solutions, which they can get by their programming skills. Thank you very much for this opportunity and thank you very much for listening to this presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Shamnan. If you can stop sharing, please. I guess yes, Dr. Abdullah, Dr. Ahmed, he would like to say something. Dr. Ahmed Al-Shahri. Yeah, okay. So before we go to the QA session, I would like to draw your attention that your opinion is very important to us for the further improvement in our next webinars. So a link is shared in the chat box for this regard. Thank you again, Dr. Shamnan. It was an appealing presentation on smart education and cyber system. It is a real need. Yes. Yes, doctor.
Okay, I thought you are going to conclude. I just want to ask some questions.
Yes, please.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, Dr. Shamnan. Thank you very much. That was very, you know, very excellent presentation. It was very informative.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, I'm just, you know, curious. You know, since the pandemic, you know, practical classes, especially in engineering, have been, you know, done online or through simulation or some, you know, through some other, you know, means.
Yes, so, sir.
I mean, in terms of IR4, what technologies are most suitable, I mean, to cover those, you know, practical courses since the students are not going to be here?
Sir, thank you very much for this question. Sir, this actually depends upon what kind of courses they are looking at. We have online simulation software for most of the courses that involve computer science. We have the programming platforms. We also have freely available software. When it comes to the use of robotics and other interdisciplinary systems, which involve a transfusion of multiple engineering disciplines, it is still limited, sir. We have access to many institute software, but it requires a login on the part of the student, which some students are not familiar with. Like, they have to create their own logins, they have to fill in some forms, so that the institutes are particular that only secure access is given for academic purposes to their software. So we'll have to identify or maybe draw like a memorandum of understanding with those institutes so that we can make use of their software, which is available. If you see in India, all higher education institutes, they have their own labs, virtual reality labs, simulation labs, which they provide free of access to other students in our country, provided the institute signs a memorandum of understanding that the access to the software, which is provided by the institutes, is safe, that students don't misuse it for the wrong purposes. So this is one solution that we can do. We can identify those institutes which have, like Stanford and MIT, these two software on deep learning is given by Stanford and MIT, but individual students will not be allowed to access it per se. So the institutes will have to sign an MOU stating that it will be used only for the right purposes, for academic reasons, and we'll have to take the responsibility so that access to their data is not compromised in any way. Sir, have I answered your question, sir?
Yes, that's very clear. I just want to request you and Dr. Majdi, and of course ETC, we can have like a meeting, a discussion on how to improve our, you know, probably, you know, how to deliver our practical, you know, courses better. And probably yes. You have some suggestions, you know, in this regard. Thank you very much, Doctor.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The University of Technology and Applied Science, Nizwa, expresses its gratitude and thanks for sharing your knowledge and skills with us, Doctor. Now, I would like to call Dr. Ahmed Ali Al-Shahri, the College Dean, for closing the event with a few remarks.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Majdi. The advances in artificial intelligence, robotics, the Internet of Things, 3D printing, genetic engineering, quantum computing, and other technologies have paved the way for us to go through experiences that our ancestors and even our fathers hadn't experienced. This, of course, created jobs and professions that were not existent 20 years ago, which caused a chain reaction that have influenced all decision makers to move from conventional planning approach to more scenario-based approach, where the system and organization would be much more flexible. I think also we as an academic or a higher education institution, we have to be adapt to the current, you know, trends in and advances in technology. So we have to have a system where we can be more flexible, not only to the market needs, but also to the job market, specific job market needs. So I think, you know, that everything is moving fast. And also as an education institution, we have to be very flexible. All the expert speakers have covered IR4 angles in one way or another. And of course, as you know, today is our second day of our series, research webinar series, UTAS-Nizwa. And I am sure all enjoyed the talks and discussions, as well as, you know, found the topic very, very interesting. Actually, I was glued to the screen the whole time for 2 hours now, you know, nonstop, just glued to the screen. So because the topic was very, very interesting. As I said before in our previous, you know, event, all the proposals, the discussions, and also the recommendations will be forwarded to His Excellency the BEC office. And of course, the intention is to be considered in the UTAS research strategy. And then I just want to have, I want to thank, there are so many people to thank here. First of all, His Excellency, Dr. Saeed Rubai, for his unlimited support. Dr. Ali Al-Mughairi, our assistant DG, for his welcome address, giving the welcome address in the beginning, and of course his endless support as well. I want to thank the organizers, Dr. Majdi, Bait Ali Suleiman, and the engineering department, your team, everybody at the engineering department. I want to also thank Dr. Khalifa Al-Shakhsi and his team, the research committee, ETC, Mr. Ishaq Al-Bandri, for your technical support all the time. I know we've been calling you, you know, every time, every second, and you've been very patient with us, not only with me, but also with the engineering team. I know they are, you know, bugging you all the time. So thank you for that, and your team as well. Of course, I want to thank you, the attendees, for their participants for joining us here today. The media committee, Mr. Ismail Riyami and his team, of course, for covering everything from before and after the every event. Most of all, I want to thank the speakers, Dr. Ahmed Al-Mashri, Dr. Abdullah Al-Hassanat, and Dr. Shimona Gracia. Thank you all very much, because without you, I'm sure this event will not have been been organized without your support, without your willingness to participate. So I'm grateful for that. Adan, thank you once again, and I hope that everybody benefited from this. We are trying to maximize the benefit by so everybody will participate. So I hope that everybody will participate or attend our next seminar. Our next seminar will be the IT seminar, the IT department seminar, and I'm looking forward, of course, to seeing you all in that webinar. Once again, thank you very much, and God bless you all. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Shukran.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you, Dr. Ahmed, and thank you all for joining us today. And we are looking forward to seeing you all again in the IT webinar, which is going to be in 2 weeks, Wednesday, the 9th of June. For more information of our series webinars, kindly refer back to the website, www.nct.edu.om. Thank you very much for your attendance. Thank you. Thank you.